Welcome. Hi, I'm Carol Nelson, the Superintendent of Schools for AlvinISD. We'd like to welcome you today to some exciting, engaging lessons that AlvinISD teachers have developed for students across the Houston metropolitan area. We have been planning over the last several weeks for our digital platform and remote learning. Today, you will see some of our amazing lessons that have been developed that have been available for our students. I hope you will enjoy. Here we go.
Good morning, friends. Welcome to our phonics lesson. Today, you might notice I've written two digraphs on the board because this digraph can make two sounds, which is even more tricky than a normal digraph. So we have this picture. What's this? A feather. So it can make a short V sound. Do it. V, V, V. Remember, it makes your lips feel a bit funny. Feather, mother, brother. Okay, so we're doing short V. And then we're doing the longer TH digraph, which makes a th sound for moth. Okay, so we have to really be super clever to do these because it's one digraph that makes two different sounds. Okay, let's start with the long sound, the long TH. The first word that we're going to write today is thin. My pencil is thin, okay? Four letters. And we know that the digraph is at the beginning. Thin, thin, okay? You should have written. Thin. Thin. If you got it right, give yourselves a check. If you need to correct it, do that now. The next word has a th at the end and it's something in your mouth. Oh, I just said a th word myself. Mouth. Mouth has a th at the end, but the word we're going to try and write, and we've practiced this one, so you should be quite good at it, is, it's got two digraphs in fact, the word is tooth. T-O-O-T-H. What two letters make an oo digraph? An O and an O, you're correct. And an double O digraph can make an U for book or an oo for moon. So that's another tricky one. Okay, tooth. You should have written T-O-O-T-H. Tooth. Okay, five letters. If you got it right, give yourselves a check. If you need to correct it, do that now. Tooth. Okay. The next word is the word cloth. I use the cleaning cloth to clean my table. Cloth. It's got a cl blend at the beginning. A cl blend is a k and an o. Cl, o, th. Five letters. One, two, three, four, five. And the digraph is at the end. So the blend cl, you should have written cl, o, and then th. Okay, cloth. If you've got it right, give yourselves a check. If you need to correct it, you can do that now. Cloth. The next word is an animal, and it actually rhymes with cloth. This animal is very, very slow. And it has three claws on each hand and it climbs a tree very, very slowly. It rhymes with cloth. What do you think it is? It's one of my favorite animals. You guessed it, it's a sloth. A sloth. Digraph goes at the end. Sl is another blend like slug. Sl. A s and a l. When you hear blends, you have to really think about what sound you can actually hear. Sl. Sl. This is what you should have written. O. Th. Sloth. Okay? If you've got it right, give yourselves a check. If you need to correct it, you can do that now. The next word is one we practice lots and lots and lots, and I think you'll be able to write it really quickly. The word is moth. Moth. Four letters and the TH goes at the end. M-O-T-H, moth. Okay, should have written m o th, moth. Okay, give yourselves a check if you got it right. If you need to correct it, do that now. This is the last word we're going to write before we go on to th. Okay, and this word is something that I tell you to do lots at school, especially if you're struggling with something. Diagraph goes at the beginning and the word is think. 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 Okay, you should have written think. That makes an unk sound. Sometimes we get that confused with the ng digraph, the ng, think. It also, if you cover this up, has the word thin in it, which we wrote earlier. Okay, now we're gonna write four v words, okay? Still a th, it just makes a slightly different sound. And the first one is that. I can do that too. Okay, that. Digraph goes at the beginning. And you can spell it th, at, that. Th, at, that. Okay? If you got it right, give yourselves a check. If you didn't get it right, correct it now. I'll get ready to write the next word. And the next word we're going to write is them. I would like to sit with them. Okay? Th, e. Them. T-H. Them. Good job. Give yourselves a check if you've got it right. If you need to correct it, do that now. Two more. Okay. The next word we're going to write is then. I did my work and then I went out to play. V-E-N. V-E-N. Okay. Then. You should have written, oh, digraph line, z-e-n, then. Give it a check if you've got it right, correct it if you need to. And the last word we're gonna write today is this. This is fun. This, this, okay? You should have written z-e. This. Give yourselves a check if you've got it right. If you need to correct it, do that now. Okay. Before you go, or before we go, should I say, Geraldine, I'm going to say some CVC words and I want you to write them on your paper as quickly as you can, okay? We're really good and we're experts at CVC words. The first word I'd like you to write is cat. 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 The next word I'd like you to write is dog. D-O-G, dog. Get that D round the right way. The next word I'd like you to write is sun. I hope the sun shines for you today. Sun. Okay. The next CVC word I would like you to write for me is bed. 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 Okay. The next CVC word I would like you to write for me is den. The lion lives in a den. Okay. And the next CVC word I want you to write for me is win. I want to win the race. Win. Okay, the next word I want you to write is hop. I can hop on one leg, or the frog can hop into the pond. Okay, the next word I would like you to write is pot. I put my cookies in my cookie pot. Yum, yum. Pot. Okay. And the last CVC word for today that I would like you to write is fog. There was a thick fog outside. Okay, so let's just read through these words again. Cat, dog, sun, bed, den, win, hop, pot, hog. I would like you, when you finish this video, to write your words and some sentences with sounds in, and then if you're feeling super clever, try and write me some sentences using these words. For example, I'll just write one before I go. I could actually try and use more than one word in my sentence. So I'm going to start with the. Oh, it's a TH word, look. The cat was in my. Oh, run out of room, so I need to go down here. Bit. What do I do at the end of a sentence? Don't forget a period. The cat was in my bed. So I've already used the word cat and bed. I wonder how many CVC words that are on this board you can use in just one sentence. There's a puzzle for you to solve. I look forward to seeing your work on Google Classroom.
Hi boys and girls, this is Mrs. Trunk again, bringing you another science lesson for this upcoming week. I hope you had a great week last week and enjoyed all the fun activities that the kindergarten teachers put together for you to practice your learning while at home. I hope you had a great weekend with your family. We miss you very much and we cannot wait to see you. And so let's move on. Last week we talked about the parts of a plant. We said the three main parts of a plant are the stem, the leaves, the roots, and then flower being kind of optional, not seen on all plants. This week, we'll be talking about the life cycle of plants. So as you know, organisms go through life cycles. Humans are organisms, animals and plants are organisms. So as you know, when babies are born, they start off very small, right? And then you keep getting older and older, and then you become an adult, like me, all the other kindergarten teachers, your parents, your grandparents. Your aunts and uncles, you become an adult. Well, animals and plants go through the same thing. For example, a baby bear is called a cub. It starts off small, and then as the years go on, it gets bigger and bigger and older. Same thing with plants. Plants start off as a seed, which we can call a baby plant. Seeds are baby plants. They start off as a seed, and they go through their life cycle and grow as well. So, we're going to talk about how many plants go through a life cycle from a seed to a seedling and then to an adult plant that produces fruit or flowers. Now, not all plants produce fruit or flowers, but a lot do. So I made an anchor chart of the five steps of a simple life cycle of a plant. So I did a tomato seed. So I would get the seed from the tomato, plant it. It would become a seedling, a small plant, to an adult plant like us adults. And then this plant would bloom a flower, my orange flower right here. And then the orange flower would eventually turn into a tomato again. And then of course, if you cut open that tomato again, you can get a seed out, plant it, become a seedling, and then just repeat it over and over again. Now, not all plants have flowers or fruits, but for those that do, this is what the cycle would look like. So there's lots of fruits other than tomato that would go through this. So for example, strawberries, bananas, grapes, all those fun fruits that y'all love to eat. They go start off as a seed. They grow into a small seedling, kind of like you guys. You guys are 5 and 6. And then you become a plant, an adult plant, like the teachers and your parents. And then the plant blooms a flower. And then that flower turns into the fruit. And then that fruit, of course, you can eat it, and then you can plant the seeds again, and it just repeats and repeats and repeats. So, with that being said, your activities for this week include one option is going into your front or backyard and finding a plant at the 5 different stages. So, for example, if you want, you can go plant your own seed, and then you can go find one in your yard that's a seedling, a small plant, not fully grown yet, but is getting there, and then you can find an adult plant, a mature plant, completely grown. You can find one with the flower, and then you could find one with the fruit. I know a few of you have fruit trees or fruit plants in your backyard.
And then another option is creating your own anchor chart, just like Mrs. Trunk, labeling each step, and then, of course, drawing a picture for each step. And then there's also the concept review game on STEM scopes to practice matching the vocabulary with the definitions of these steps. And then, of course, there's a brain pop video that also is another video lesson for this week that can help you understand life cycles better, okay? So this was plant life cycles. So your job this week is to observe with your eyes and your other senses, seeing, listening, you can taste the fruit, actually. That's a great idea. Touching, and then, of course, smelling, observing through your five senses, young and adult plants in your backyard, front yard, wherever you can find one, even at the park if you go on a walk with your family. So I hope you have a great week this week, and good luck on all your assignments, and we'll see you next week. Bye, guys.
Hey, friends. Today we're looking at division problems where we know our total, and we know how much goes into a group, but we're gonna find out how many groups. That's what we're solving for, how many groups. So let's look at our word problem. Elise is filling vases with flowers to place on tables at a party. She has 24 flowers. She uses exactly 6 flowers for each vase. How many vases can Elise fill with flowers? So we know we have 24 flowers, and we know that 6 flowers go into one vase. So how many vases is what we are solving for? Now, these type of word problems, we're gonna model them a little differently. So I know I have 24, and I know that 6 flowers can go into a vase. So this is how I'm gonna start. I'm gonna start counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is a vase. 6. Now I've got to fill up enough vases to where they fill up with 24 flowers. So I'm going to keep going. Another 6 here. And that makes a vase. So I have 6 here. Now let me count how I have next. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So I'm trying to get up to 24. So let me fill another vase. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I've got 6 flowers here. Let's count how many this is. I had 12 over here, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 flowers, trying to get to that 24 flowers. So let me put another vase together with 6 flowers. So is that 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. So I see that it took 1, 2, 3, 4 vases. Now, let me go ahead. I know in my TEK I have to be able to create and describe. So let's go to create. Now, create is where we do our repeated subtraction equation. So when I'm doing repeated subtraction, I know my total, this 24, is my first number. Next, I'm going to take that 6, and I'm going to keep subtracting 6 till I get to 0. So 24 minus 6 is 18, so I need to keep subtracting. 16 minus 6 gives me 12, so I'm going to keep subtracting. 12 minus 6 gives me 6, so I'm going to keep subtracting, and 6 minus 6 gives me 0. Now let's look at how many times did we subtract 6 to get to 0. 1, 2, 3, 4 times, and 4 vases was my answer. So last, what we need to do is we need to describe our word problem. Just like we did with multiplication, just like we did earlier in the week with our division word problems. So I go to describe. Now when I'm describing, I'm gonna start first with that total number of flowers, which was 24 flowers. So we're gonna put 24 flowers separated into groups of 6. Fills 4 vases. So 24 flowers separated into groups of 6. These are all groups of 6. Fills 1, 2, 3, 4 vases. All right, now your turn to get a word problem and go ahead and model it, create it, writing the subtraction, repeated subtraction equation, and then describing it in words. And the description part will be a fill in the blank. Good luck.
everyone. My name is Heather Benbrook, and I'm an elementary school counselor in AlvinISD. Today, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about stress. I'm sure that many of us are feeling a little extra stress right now with the COVID-19 pandemic. And so I just wanted to share some resources and some strategies to help you and your kiddos through this difficult time. The most important thing for us to do right now is to protect and keep our bodies and our mind and our souls healthy. And we want to make sure we're doing things to help ourselves and help our kids as well. Because when we feel stress, our kids feel stress too. And so I wanted to share a resource with you real quick before I share some strategies. Julie Kaplow is a PhD. She's an associate professor of psychology at Baylor College of Medicine. And she said, you know, with stressors and big change like we're experiencing right now, we're going to see some regressive tendencies or some behavior changes, not only in ourselves, but in our children as well. So we just need to be aware of that. And also, we can help our kids. She called it the six S's. The first one is safety and security. We want to make sure that we're keeping ourselves safe and secure. And part of that right now, according to the CDC, is to protect ourselves and make sure that we're isolating ourselves in our homes, which is why we're speaking about this right now. So we want to make sure that everything is safe and secure. We feel that safety and security, and we tell that to our children as well. The second one is to keep a simple language. We want to make sure that we keep it age appropriate for our kids when we're talking to them. And that can be kind of difficult sometimes, because sometimes we don't want to tell them too much, but we don't want to tell them too little either. So just make sure it's simple and it's age appropriate. The next one is supervision. We want to make sure that we're just keeping an eye on the kids and making sure we're aware of those changes if we see any in them. The next one is structure. Of course, you know, we all like structure, and right now our structure is a little off because of, you know, having to be at home and in a different environment and learning in a different way. So with change, that structure is a little bit skewed right now, but we want to make sure we keep as much structure and routine as possible, which can be hard. The next one is social support. Social support is very important. We want to make sure, even though we cannot be physically together, we want to make sure that we're supporting each other and spreading kindness and making sure that, you know, we're here for each other. We're better together. And so I'm sure many AlvinISD staff and teachers have been reaching out to help and support you. And so I want you to know that we are all here, and all the elementary counselors around the district are here, and you can always check their websites for any help or reach out to them as well. And the last one is self-care. So this one's probably one of the harder ones. They always say, put your mask on before you put someone else's mask on an airplane. And that's because we have to take care of ourselves before we can help others. And so today I wanted to share some strategies with you to help with that. Some of the most important things are very simple, like go outside, enjoy the sun, get that vitamin D. They say that that helps you stay healthy and it helps you fight off any illnesses as well. Playing a game, doing puzzles with your kids, going outside and exercising, or going inside and exercising, whatever needs to happen. Just make sure that you're laughing and you're smiling and you're keeping your body and your mind and your soul healthy. And the last thing I wanted, a couple other things I wanted to share with you, are there are plenty of resources and books. Wanted to share this one with you. It's called A Little Spot of Anxiety, A Story About Calming Your Worries. And so there's a quick little breathing strategy in here that I wanted to share with you. If you just hold up your hand, you're going to pretend like there's the stress at the end of each of your fingers. And so the middle is where we're going to put that worry and that stress. And it says, from the tip of my finger to the middle of my palm, I can do this. I can stay calm. And so with each breath, you take a deep breath in, deep breath out, deep breath in, deep breath out, 5 times. And you take it and you blow away the worry. So that's one little quick strategy for breathing. There's tons of apps as well out there that will help you stay calm. There's one called Calm, and there's Headspace, and there's all kinds of different other apps out there and websites that can help you. There's another quick breathing strategy that I like to use. This one is the figure eight. It's just breathing in and breathing out. Then there's the triangle breathing, where you breathe in for 3 seconds, hold it for 3 seconds, and breathe out for 3 seconds. And I found those at copingskillsforkids.com, which is an excellent resource as well. So like I said, just make sure we're here for each other. We're better together. And reach out if you need help, and we're here to help. And I thank you so much for everything that you do and everything that we're doing together to help our kids. We love them and we miss everyone, and we're here. So reach out. Have a great day.
Welcome, my beach bums. My name is Rod. That's R-O-D. D as in dog. But you can call me Righteous Rod, the Review Dude for short. Are you ready for some review? Make sure you got your leash on your board while we catch some totally sick review waves, man. For this review today, dude, we're gonna go on a virtual surfing trip, bruh. Imagine you on your board, paddling out to carve up some sickest waves of the day, bruh. So you can paddle out with 50 newtons of force, bruh. And the current against you is gonna be 25 newtons of force, dude. What would happen? You would like get totally far out, man. Because the current has 25 newtons less force than your force. Therefore, you're going to move forward with a force of 25 newtons, bruh. Righteous, dude.
Now imagine you're at the beach with your board watching some totally tubular 10-foot waves crashing down. Oh, man. You're so amped to catch one of those gnarly waves, bruh. So you get your board and start paddling out with your 50 newtons of force. But now, these giant waves, man, their force is 150 newtons, bruh. Dude. What will happen? Crash and burn, dude. You're like not gonna catch these waves today, bro. You're 50 newtons against 150 newtons. That's gonna push you back with a force of 100 newtons, bruh. Not today, man.
So now you're stuck in the surf, man. But look, wait, it's a bird. It's a plane. Nah, even better, it's a jet ski. Pulling some surfers out to sea, bruh. So you yell out, "Hey man, help a dude out." He's like, "Yeah, I got you, bruh." So
you and that jet ski, you battle your 50 newtons of force with the jet ski's 160 newtons of force, which gives you a total of 210 newtons of force going out to catch the monster's waves. But wait, bruh, still 150 newtons of waves are coming at you. So we take those off. We get a total of 60 newtons of force going out to catch some monster waves, bruh. So now you're in the lineup, dude. You just sit on your board, just chilling, wait for that next big swell. As you sit on your board, you're applying 30 newtons of force on your board, on the water. That force is applying 30 newtons of force back on you. What happens? You're right, man. Nothing. Because the net force is zero. You're totally balanced with that water, man. It's so sweet. to be part of that tide and balanced with that tide, brah. So you're just sitting and maxing, relaxing, looking over the horizon, waiting for your wave to come. And it's your time, man. This is your moment. While you're waiting for the wave to come up, you think of what your old brother Newton said with his first law of motion. An object at rest remains at rest until acted upon by an outside force. So you think to yourself, self? You better move, dude, or this totally sick wave is going to force itself on you and crash on you, dude. As your wave comes, you start to paddle out to catch it. And right when you hit that wave, you stand up and you think, man, I'm on top of the world. Until what pops its head out of the water? A whale, bruh. Too late to react. Your board slams into that whale. And you do what? You go flying over top of that whale in the air, because you remember the other part of Newton's first law. An object in motion is going to remain in motion until acted upon by an outside force. So you just keep flying until gravity slams you back into that water. Check, man. You totally stopped moving, brah, because that water, it acted on you. Ouch, bruh.
Good thing you were close to the beach, brother. You were able to grab your board and exert that last 25 newtons of force you can to catch the 150 newtons of force waves to push you back on the shore very quickly. With a total force of 150 newtons plus 50 newtons, 175 newtons of force going back to shore, bro.
Good luck, dudes. Respect your fellow surfers. We're all trying to catch a break. I gotta go pick up some chicks.
Ride the wave, bruh.
Hi, my name is Donna Pauly.
And I'm Kelly Smith.
We are English teachers from Alvin High School in Alvin, Texas. And before we get started, Kelly, get that measuring tape out there. Are we far enough apart? Perfect. Social distancing on point.
So April is National Poetry Month, and one of the things we know is we can become better writers by reading our favorite authors and poets.
So first things first, we decided that we'd talk about some of the basic devices that poets use. And one thing that they use is a simile. And a simile is when we make a comparison between two things that are unlike, using like or as or than. So I chose from Witch Wife, written by Edna St. Vincent Millay, one of my favorite poets, the line, her voice is like a string of colored beads. So it's making a connection between her voice and the beads.
Another device that poets use a lot, and writers, is a metaphor. And a metaphor is similar to a simile, where it compares two unlike things, but it does not use like or as. It simply says one thing is the other. So, for example, from Emily Dickinson's poem, we have, hope is a thing with feathers that perches on the soul. And what we know is this is an implied metaphor where she's comparing hope to a bird, and we know she means a bird because she's using things like feathers and perches.
The third device we're going to talk about is imagery. And while most people think about imagery as being able to picture or see something that you read or you listen to, imagery actually picks up all five of your senses. So we chose from Robert Frost his poem After Apple Picking, and the lines are, I feel the ladder sway as the boughs bend, and I keep hearing from the cellar bin the rumbling sound of load on load of apples coming in. So we have the sense of touch with the ladder that's swaying. We have the sense of sound with the sound of the apples as they fall in the bin. And we actually have a picture of the apples themselves.
The last one that we're going to talk about is alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of sounds at the beginning of words. So we use an example from Samuel Taylor Coleridge's The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew, the furrow followed free. We were the first that ever burst into that silent sea. So alliteration helps with a whimsical feeling in your writing.
Mrs. Smith and I are poetry nerds, which means we have a lot of poetry books at our house. In case you don't have any, we're going to give you some good sites that you could look up on your phone. So the first one is Poetry 180, A Poem a Day for American High Schools, and that's done by poet Billy Collins. Has a lot of great ideas with very contemporary poetry. The second one is Poetry Foundation, which is a national institute. It has classic and also contemporary poetry. And the last is poets.org. And I just want to read you a quote from their front page, which reads, "Without poetry, we lose our way."
Okay, so we want to talk about sharing poetry with our neighbors and friends and ways to do that. So grab some chalk and follow us outside.
Don't worry, Miss Smith, I'm 6 feet behind you.
One fun thing you can do with the chalk is to write poems on your neighbor's driveway. So I picked out a special poem just for my neighbor, Luke. Say hi, Luke. And it's by Shel Silverstein. It says, "Let's have a day for all girls and boyses when you can make the grandest noises. Screech, scream, holler, yell, buzz a buzzer, ring a bell, sneeze,
hiccup,
and whistle, shout, laugh until your lungs wear out."
So for these neighbors, I picked a blessing from Emily Dickinson. It's real simple. It reads, "In the name of the bee and of the butterfly and of the breeze. Amen." For the second neighbor, I picked a poem by Edna St. Vincent Millay called First Fig. And I think it really works for today because as teachers, public school teachers in Texas, we're doing distance teaching and learning for the first time. And it's been really hard, but we're doing the best we can. So my poem is, "My candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night. But all my foes and oh my friends, it gives a lovely light."
So I picked, "Buttercups have honeyed hearts, bees they love the clover, but I love the daisies dance all the meadow over." For this sweet neighbor, I picked one of my favorite poems, or a piece of it, one that we saw a little bit of earlier. "Hope is a thing with feathers that perches on the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all." Emily Dickinson.
I also chose an Emily Dickinson poem, and my poem reads, "To make a prairie, it takes a clover and one bee, one clover and a bee, and reverie. The reverie alone will do if bees are few." Emily Dickinson. Hey, Kelly, do you know what you call a really, really indecisive bee?
I don't. What do you call it when?
A maybe. Wah, wah.
So another thing you can do is read poetry out loud to your neighbors from a safe distance, of course.
I got my tape ready.
All right, yardsticks aren't just for discipline. Social distancing. You may have to just...
Hold your horses there, ma'am. I gotta make sure we're 6 feet apart.
All right. Wow.
All right, we're good to go.
So, I have a poem for you that I picked just for you because you're my neighbor.
Aww.
Portrait by a neighbor. Before she has her floor swept or her dishes done, any day you find her a-sunning in the sun. It's long after midnight, her keys in the lock, and if you ever see her chimney smoke, till past 10 o'clock. She digs in her garden with a shovel and a spoon. She weeds her lazy lettuce by the light of the moon. She walks up the walk like a woman in a dream. She forgets she borrowed butter and pays you back in cream. Her lawn looks like a meadow, and if she mows the place, she leaves the clover standing and the Queen Anne's lace.
Well, that was amazing. Thank you for sharing that with me. That was awesome. Wow, are y'all just out going to all the neighbors' houses?
We are spreading poetry joy.
That is wonderful. That is great news.
So, did you know that when I was outside the other day, the cops stopped and said, hey, people have been complaining about your dogs chasing other people on bicycles? And I said, that's crazy. My dogs don't even have bicycles.
Wah, wah.
Wah, wah.
So April is National Poetry Month, and at the end of the month, there's a thing that's called Poem in Your Pocket. So I have a poem in my pocket for you. And it's actually one of my favorite poets, and I think you'll appreciate this. Her name is Jill Alexander Esbaum, and she's a well-known poet. She graduated from Alvin High School with my little brother. So I'm going to read her poem that's actually called Poem. A clementine of inclement climate grows tart. A crocus too stoic to open won't. Like an oyster that cloisters a spoil of pearls untouched, the heart that's had enough stay shut. Thanks for being such a good neighbor.
You're very welcome. That's the least I can do. Thank you for spreading the joy.
You are.
So we've talked about how to share other people's poems with your neighbors and your friends, and now we want to talk about how we can write our own poems and use poets that we like as an inspiration, or we can imitate them. So first of all, shout out to Kwame Alexander, who's letting us use a poem from his awesome book, Out of Wonder, Poems Celebrating Poets. Thank you, Kwame. All right, so we're going to talk about the poem, How to Write a Poem Celebrating Naomi Shihab Nye.
And the poem reads, hush, grab a pencil, some paper, spunk, let loose your heart, raise your voice. What if I have many voices? Let them dance together, twist and turn like best friends in a maze, till you find that one true word or two.
Okay, so what we did is we took Kwame Alexander's poem and we made what we call a frame. So this is going to help us imitate his style and structure. So first, we'll start with the title, How to Write a Poem Celebrating Naomi Shihab Nye. So we're going to say how to blank celebrating a person.
Okay, I really think this poem should be topical for today. So my poem is going to be How to Survive a Quarantine.
I like it.
And instead of celebrating another poet, I think I'm just going to have mine say celebrating community.
Okay, so we notice the first stanza is actually just one word. It's a command, a single word command. So that's how Donna's gonna start her poem.
Okay, so if we're surviving a quarantine, I think the first thing that every single one of us did was we all just stopped. So I'm gonna start my poem with stop.
Okay. All right, the next stanza we notice has three lines, also imperative, grab a pencil, some paper, spunk. So we have in our frame, grab a blank, some blank, and then we need an abstract noun.
Okay, so how about this? How about grab a mask?
Like it.
Some Clorox wipes, which nobody can find in the grocery
right.
store now. And I think for the noun, the abstract noun for this one, since this is new for all of us, I'm going to just use the word patience.
Okay. Then we're gonna go in to the next stanza. Let loose your heart with a dash. So let loose what?
Okay, so if I'm thinking about myself and about my students too, the one thing that I had to let loose of is I had to let loose of some of my friendships that I don't see every day at school. So mine's gonna read, let loose your friends.
All right, and then we follow that with another imperative phrase, raise your voice. So okay. Here we're gonna say raise.
Okay, so if I'm not around my friends at school, I'm gonna put raise your solitude. Raise your solitude.
Okay.
All right. Now notice that Kwame switches to a different voice in the poem, and we have a question. What if I have many voices?
Okay, so if I'm thinking along the same line about not being able to see my friends at school, I'm going to put, what if I miss my friends?
All right. Okay, and now we're back to the last, almost last stanza, the long one. Let them dance together. So let them, what could you say?
Well, if you think about the ways that we can communicate with each other, how about let them Skype together?
I like that.
Okay, let them Skype together.
Technological.
All right.
That we have alliteration that we talked about earlier. So the repetition of sounds. So he has twist and turn.
You want to hear some teenage lingo I picked up in
Please.
The last month? We're going to put tweet.
Okay.
And here it comes, TikTok.
Nice.
Oh, I'm going to misspell it just the way they misspell it on TikTok.
Okay. Okay. Then we're going to go into a simile, which we talked about before, followed by a prepositional phrase. So he has like best friends in a maze. I love that line.
Okay. So I'm thinking about the idea of like we're separated from each other, but we're still a part of each other. So my simile and prepositional phrase is going to be like branches of a tree.
Okay. All right, and now we have our last little section, till you find that one true word. So we're gonna have till, so what are you thinking? Till you...
I know that my students are thinking about when we can actually come back together, hopefully this school year, if not next school
hopefully.
Year. And I think mine is gonna be till you share
okay.
that one true reunion.
Nice. And then of course at the very end we have a parenthetical or two.
And sometimes I think the poet says it so well that there's no way that you can improve it. So I'm just going to use his line. I'm going to put or two. So now this is how you take a frame from a published poem and then you make it your own.
Okay. We'd like to tell you about one final way to share your poetry with the world, and that's with letter writing. And the art of letter writing is completely lost these days. So I have just written a little note to my sister. I'm sharing with her an Edna St. Vincent Millay poem called The Goose Girl that starts, "Spring rides no horses down the hill, but comes on foot, a goose girl still. And all the loveliest things there be come simply so, it seems to me." And so I'm going to put this in my envelope. I'm going to seal it up. I've already put her address on it. I'm going to give it a stamp. And then the next step is to the box outside.
So that's our lesson for the day. We want to say thanks for joining us. We hope you learned something and have a happy National Poetry Month.
Hey, Kelly, I forgot to tell you. You know they've closed all the restaurants around here, but believe it or not, they've opened a brand new restaurant just around the corner, and it's called Karma.
Karma? What's on the menu?
They don't have a menu. You get what you deserve. And don't forget, everybody,
Jacket Pride never does.
Hey, guys, it's Miss DeBerry, and I am here to give you a little extra help with rational numbers. So we're going to skip that. All right. So ordering rational numbers, and I know there's a video the district provided. I just want to break it down a little bit more. So here are the numbers that we are starting with: negative 6 3/100, 6%, 6/8, and 6/800. So, step one, we're going to put all the numbers in the same format. I prefer decimals. They're just a little easier to work with rather than making them all percents or all fractions. So I'm going to do that, and I'm going to use the power triangle that's in the resources in the class notes that Mr. Tice posted. Here it is again. And, you know, maybe like try to remember what it looked like hanging on the wall in the classroom. And so my first number here, -6 3/100, is already in a decimal format. I don't even have to do anything for that. But 6% on the power triangle, I am going from a percent to a decimal, so I have to go backwards. Okay. And so that means I'm going to move the decimal instead of to the right. I'm going to move it to the left two places. If you want to get real picky, I'm technically dividing by 100, but that would make this 0.06. Okay, so I've scooped once and twice. 6/8, if I'm doing 6/8, I'm going from a fraction to a decimal. We're doing top in, bottom out. Okay, so that would make me go 6 divided by 8. So 8 goes into 6 zero times. Add decimals. 8 goes into 67 times. That'd be 56. 60 minus 56 is 4. Add a zero. Bring it down. And 8 goes into 45 times, so that makes this 0.75. And then my last number is also already a decimal, so I'm in pretty good shape here. So now I've done step one, and we're on to step two. Sorry, just trying to use two programs at once. It's fun. So now I need my slideshow to change. Okay. And we're going to get rid of those notations. So step one, we've put the numbers in the same format. I have them up here at the top in the decimal format and then in their original format underneath. Step two, we're going to order these numbers by comparing the decimal places. So you may want to take them and stack them so all the decimals are lined up. That's one way to do it. I'm not going to do that just for ease of the program I'm using. Nope. Let's back that up. Okay, so I have here, this number is a negative and all the other numbers are positive. So without any other information, I know that the negative number is smaller than everything else. But then I'm going to look at my tenths place. I have a 0, a 7, and a 6. So if I'm ordering from least to greatest, which has the least in the tenths place? That's going to be the 0. This is the least in the tenths place. The next one, so this would be our smallest. This would be our second smallest. This next smallest number in the tenths place is a 6. So this is my third smallest. And then this would be my fourth smallest, which is technically my largest one. Okay. And they correspond underneath here. So when we go to the next part, when I'm going to my next part here, I put them in the same order. I've compared their decimal places, and now I'm going to place them in the number line, but I'm going to have to use that original format. So, got me a number line here. I'll make it a little bigger. The smallest one we already said was -6.03. The second smallest would be 0.6. And if I make this 0, 0.6, my number line is not going to be to scale. 0.6 would 0.06, that's super tiny. That's gonna be like right here, okay? So I'm going to label these with letters. So this would be B. And then 75 hundredths would be over here, so that's C. And then D would be close to that, okay? So I used, first I put the numbers in the same format into decimals. Next, I ordered them by comparing the decimal places. And then last, I put them on the number line using their original format. So I just wanted to go through those steps with you so it was very clear what you needed to do to compare. I miss you guys, and feel free to email me or get on our meetings on Mondays and Wednesdays and Fridays from 12 to 1, and I will see you there. Bye.
Welcome back. We hope you enjoyed the engaging lessons that our AlvinISD staff prepared for you today. We want to thank not only our parents and community for your support, but also for our teachers who have put in tireless hours preparing these lessons, as well as taking care of their own children at home. So we want to thank everyone. We know these are trying times, but we also want to let you know that we're here for you, and we will continue to provide these lessons through a digital platform as well as remote learning platform. So thank you again. Stay safe. We'll see you soon.